Often times phones from Realme and Poco are just carbon copies of some other device with a fresh coat of paint. But sometimes they do surprise us with one that really stands out and breaks the monotony of the usual status quo and is really good deal for the price. Today, we are gonna see if the Poco F3 GT is one such device while we unbox it and see how it stacks up to the likes of OnePlus Nord 2. Hey guys, this is Anantan, and yes, I know my voice sounds weird. I've been sick for the past couple of days, so sorry for the delay with the unboxing. Now let's roll. We've got a stealthy black box here with the trademark Poco branding, an MRP sticker up top, and F3 GT in big bold text to the sides, and a bag full of spec highlights. This is the Predator Black 6128GB variant here with us. Let's rip through the seals on either side, and yet another logo placement on the yellow insert with a handy pull tab. Here we have the SIM ejector tool, a quick start guide, a 3.5mm to Type-C converter to remind you that the phone does not have a headphone jack, and a clear soft TPU case. Now let's move on to the real deal, the Poco F3 GT. In its all matte black glory, first impressions, the back has a gamery aesthetic to it. Sharp lines and designs etched onto the frosted glass, giving it a dual tone finish. We'll let the phone boot and check out the other accessories in the box. A 67W Sonic charger and a fancy Type-C cable in trademark Poco yellow color. Now that we are done with the unboxing, let's get to the device itself. The Poco F3 GT feels super nice in the hand. The back is textured really well and feels solid with its 205 grams weight. The camera array here looks really striking, and it even has a tactical RGB lighting to the top and the bottom of the camera bump. The flash is in the form of a lightning bolt. That's something new, and it does look really sexy. Now the back is matte, so you wouldn't pick up many fingerprints, but boy does it feel slippery. It feels like a bar of soap. The included silicone case is much appreciated. One qualm we have is how wide the phone feels in hand. It doesn't seem that bad as compared to the ROG phone when you look at it, but with the flat back and sides, it feels quite wide in hand. Just my two cents. Thankfully, Poco have kept the branding to a minimum, and it looks classy. The back is covered with Gorilla Glass 5, as is the display to the front. This phone has one of the weirdest assortment of buttons I have ever seen. The left has the volume rockers and a microphone. We'll get to why there is a microphone on the left side a little later. The top has the second microphone, weird looking speaker grills, and an IR blaster. It is so nice to see Poco make room for an IR blaster. It is such an underrated feature. The bottom features a Type-C port and a dual SIM card slot. Sadly, no microSD expansion. The right has the maglev shoulder triggers followed by a slider to lock them in place. This seems like a very odd choice in my opinion. Even if it had a reason beyond the insanely satisfying sound they make when you toggle them on and off, why did Poco have to go and put individual locks on the triggers is beyond me. Sandwiched between them is a power button with an integrated fingerprint scanner that works flawlessly every time. Coming from any other phone, the top slider will 100% be mistaken for a power button and would annoy people. Let's move on to the display. The Poco F3 GT has a 6.67 inch Full HD Plus Super AMOLED display with a 120Hz refresh rate. I like the fact that no corners were cut with respect to the display. It's bright, vivid, and the colors are punchy. We even checked if there was color shift off axis, and it was fine. To be honest, we have seen much more expensive phones that do far worse in this regard. So, good job Poco. We get touch sampling rates of up to 480Hz. That's awesome too. When you build a smartphone around a gaming pillar, all these are boxes that need to be checked. So again, good job Poco. But what is powering this beautiful display? This time around, we have a Dimensity 1200 and a Mali G77 MC9 GPU combo, coupled with 6 or 8 gigs of LPDDR4X RAM and 128 or 256 gigs of UFS 3.1 storage. There is a 5065mAh battery keeping the wheels turning. Now, we have seen devices in the past porting the Dimensity 1200 before. The Nord 2 had it. We even did a shorts to test the thermal performance and gaming prowess of the Nord 2. Here's the card to it. We didn't expect the Poco F3 GT to do any worse, and are pleased to say that we were not mistaken. Call of Duty on medium and high settings ran smoothly. There were occasional drops with high settings, but this was more to do with the game itself lagging versus any device bottleneck. We tried Genshin Impact next. It too ran smoothly on medium settings, but was choppy when graphics were cranked up all the way. We will have more on this once we get to test the device for the full review, and I promise you that I will have a better voice. We also noticed there wasn't too much of a battery drop while we played the game shooting b-rolls for this video. But even if there was a drop in the battery percentage, you could charge it back up with the included 67W charger almost as fast as you could drain it playing the games. I don't know about you guys, but I am a sucker for ultra fast charging like this. There is no mention on the official site regarding the time. We guesstimate to be around 40 minutes. We would be remiss if we don't talk about that charging cable. It has a yellow cable that looks remarkably like an Ethernet cable. But what's special about it is the fact that it comes with an L-band USB-C connector that lets the cable sit flush with the bottom of the device while holding it in landscape and gaming. This is good attention to detail from Poco, and we are pleasantly surprised by it. Let me take a moment to talk about the MagLev, the magnetic levitating shoulder triggers. They came in clutch while playing shooters like Call of Duty, eliminating the need for learning the four-finger claw. They work really well. You can assign them to mimic a touch on any part of the screen, just like the other implementation. Me personally, I usually game on one of the ROGs at work. Sorry, Ash. But anyways, I found the ROG implementation better than this, especially because you could configure the sensitivity of the triggers, thereby eliminating the accidental process. It is also worth noting that Poco has put in a vapor chamber to help with the heat during marathon sessions. This did help, and it did keep the phone from getting too hot. The additional microphone to the side we saw earlier came in handy, as my teammates said it sounded crystal clear, like I am sounding right now. But let me ask you guys this. Who is gonna play shooters without earphones or headphones? Let me know in the comments below. The software out of the box is MIUI 12.5 built on top of Android 11, and we aren't gonna go into detail about this as we have beaten it to death covering other Xiaomi, Redmi and Poco phones in the past. The UI wasn't slow or sluggish, and on the contrary, with the high refresh rate and touch sampling, felt very fast, and we noticed no stutters during our short time with it. We will be sure to test it out in detail in a full review and let you guys know if there is anything to bitch about. The cameras here seem better than what you'd generally get on a gaming phone. It's not gonna blow you away or anything, but it retains plenty of detail, and the images turned out pretty good when you give enough light. But I am getting ahead of myself here. The sexiest rear camera array consists of a 64MP f1.7 shooter, an 8MP f2.2 lens, and an absolutely useless 2MP macro camera. Hey Poco and every other brand, please don't pad the array with useless sensors like this. If it's absolutely necessary, go ahead and add something like a periscope lens. Coming back to how the picture looked, we found them to be quite good considering for the price tag. Thanks to that f1.7 primary, the bokeh was good and tasteful. The pictures came out looking cooler than neutral. Not cooler as in cooler, but cool as in the temperature skews towards the blue end of the spectrum. In my opinion, better cool than warm. What we did notice is the color shift when we moved from the primary to the 8MP ultrawide. It was annoying, but I suppose it can't be helped given the difference in the sensors. We are pointedly not gonna talk about the macro camera because it's irrelevant. Video shot with the rear camera were good. Nothing to write home about, but nothing to cripple about either. The video caps out at 4K 30fps. You can however shoot up to 120fps if you go down to 1080p. We will have a thorough report for you on the cameras once we spend enough time with it. The selfie camera was rather good, at par with every other implementation of the 16MP sensor we have been seeing over the last few years. The normal selfies looked detailed, but the portrait mode had terrible edge detection and fake bokeh. This phone at first glance seems to be quite good. Good specs, 67W charging, beautiful display, IR blaster and a plethora of mics, the vapor chamber, decent camera and the shoulder triggers. But all this would be irrelevant without factoring the price. The base variant of Poco F3 GT 6128 comes in at 27,000 rupees and the A256 comes in at 31,000 rupees. This puts it in direct comparison to the Note 2 5G from OnePlus. The base variant of the Note is 3K more than the F3 GT, but it also has 2 more gigs of RAM. Whether the extra 2 gigs is worth the premium is up to you, the end users, to decide. We will be sure to do a more detailed comparison as part of our review. With that, we get to the end of this video, and if you guys enjoyed it, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe if you haven't already. Until next time, this is Anandan from C4A Tech signing off. Ciao.